Guys, you have no idea how much it costs to make one of these audio amplifiers. Actually, I'm not sure either. We'll do the math later in the video, but I have a feeling the numbers will surprise you. Of course, that is not because this tiny 2-watt amplifier is expensive. Quite the opposite. It is based around this ridiculously cheap 4-cent integrated circuit. That is not $4, 4 cents. $4 will actually get me 100 of these. Well, actually 120 because the price goes down the more you buy, but you get the idea. This chip is cheap. So when I found it over on LCSC, it got me wondering, how much would it cost to make a working amplifier with this chip? How low can I go? And is this chip any good in the first place? Step one of this challenge was to examine the datasheet. It is in Chinese, which I can't say I speak very well, but hey, that company name sounds interesting. Fortunately, it was easy to get all the necessary information. The wiring diagram seems simple enough, all the pins are listed and labeled, and Google Translate handles the rest pretty well. So I went ahead and bought the chip and all the parts necessary to make it work. Now it's time for the fun part, designing the circuit board. This step is necessary if you want to use this chip for anything practical. It is an SMD component, meaning that it is designed to be soldered on the surface of the PCB. Technically, you can use one of these adapters that make SMD chips fit on a breadboard, but I chose to make my own PCB instead. Making custom circuit boards for your own projects has never been easier or cheaper, thanks to JLCPCB, the sponsor of this video. For as little as $2, you can get professional quality PCBs shipped worldwide for next to nothing. And if you think that designing PCBs is difficult, it's really not, thanks to JLCPCB's online PCB design tool, EasyEDA. I mean, it's called that for a reason. With EasyEDA, you can draw schematics using real components and then easily convert them to a PCB ready for manufacturing. You can have the blank PCBs delivered straight to your door, or you can use JLCPCB's assembly services to have the components professionally soldered for you. And if you're feeling creative, JLCPCB offers full-color silkscreen to make your projects both functional and beautiful. Get your $10 coupon on 6-layer PCBs at jlcpcb.com. Here I am in EasyEDA, and I have already drawn a schematic for my amplifier using parts from LCSC and the example circuit from the chip's datasheet. And for the PCB itself, I have a set of targets. First of all, I want it to be small, but at the same time, I want to be able to solder everything by hand. That's why I'm using 0805 SMD components, though if you've never done SMD soldering, you should probably start with a larger size like 1206. I also want my PCB to be breadboard friendly, which is why I'm placing all connections on the same side along a single row of pin headers. These holes in the corners will allow the PCB to be mounted if that's necessary. The example circuit shows only a single 1 microfarad tantalum capacitor across the power supply rails, but for good measure, I'm also adding a bulk 220 microfarad electrolytic. It will be interesting to test if this makes any difference. On the input side, we see a 0.39 microfarad capacitor in series with the signal. While working on this project, I came across an interesting article by Analog explaining how different capacitor types affect audio signals. It recommended using electrolytics, but also pointed out that film capacitors perform best, while ceramics are the worst for the job. So I decided to experiment with this. On the PCB, I have two spots for input capacitors, one for an SMD ceramic, and the other is for a large film capacitor. Pin 1 can be used to make a power switch, but I'm connecting it straight to ground, so the chip will be on as long as it has voltage supplied to it. I am now making the tracks for the power input and the audio output slightly wider, since they're going to carry more current. Finally, I am making a 4x4 PCB panel. This is not necessary, but for a few extra dollars, I'll get a ton more identical copies of the PCB. Now I can export my Gerber file and upload it to JLCPCB for manufacturing. A few days later, I got the PCBs delivered to me in a pretty blue box. I also got all the components I ordered from LCSC. The PCBs look great, as expected, so let's fire up the soldering iron and put this thing together. To solder the chip, you start by dropping some solder on one of the corner pads. Then you take the chip with your tweezers, melt the solder again, and slide the chip into place. After that, solder the leg in the opposite corner to keep the chip from moving around. You can solder the rest now, just take it easy and try not to put too much heat on the chip. For the other SMD components, you do the same. A drop of solder on one pad, slide in the component, solder on the other side, easy peasy. And when soldering pin headers, I like to put them in a breadboard. This keeps them aligned during soldering. Here I have a finished amplifier and it's time to see if it works. I am feeding it 5 volts from my power supply and an audio signal from my phone. It does seem to work, but it's quieter than expected. Looking at the datasheet, I realized why. This feedback resistor sets the gain, so increasing its value will give me more amplification. But what value should I use? To find out, I put another amplifier together with one small change. Instead of a feedback resistor, I connected a precision potentiometer. This allowed me to adjust the gain, so I increased it right up to the point before the sound got distorted. I measured a resistance of 71 kilo-ohms. The closest value resistor I had was 68 kilo-ohms, so that is what I used. And now the amplifier sounds much louder. I have to say, the sound is pretty clean too, with no immediately noticeable distortion or hissing when no music is playing. Will it make a difference if I replace the input film capacitor with a smaller ceramic one? Time to find out! Here I have an almost identical amplifier, and the only difference is the input capacitor. Looking at the two on the oscilloscope, I cannot seem to detect much of a difference between the two signals, and the frequency doesn't affect things either. Going back to the article I mentioned earlier, there are two potential issues with using ceramic caps in the audio input line. Number one, they might behave as a capacitor of lower value, potentially blocking low frequencies. And number two, they might pick up vibrations and cause distortion. But in my case, the ceramic capacitor appears to be working fine, plus it is much cheaper than the film capacitor I also used. So for basic projects like this one, ceramic caps seem to be okay. Another thing I want to test is what would happen if I skip the bigger capacitor that wasn't included in the example circuit. The result? Again, I cannot hear or measure any difference, although the results may vary depending on the power supply. And now, time to find out how much it costs to make one amplifier like this. As I said in the beginning, the chip costs about 4 cents. This makes it cheaper than both the film and the tantalum capacitors I used. The electrolytic costs 3 cents, the resistors and ceramic cap cost about 1 cent altogether, the pin header is 2 cents, and from JLCPCB I got 80 PCBs for about $8, making them 10 cents each, for a total of just 32 cents per amplifier. But if you skip the film and electrolytic cap, the price goes down to 24 cents. Isn't this amazing? Imagine what you can do with a whole dollar. Thanks again to JLCPCB for sponsoring this video, and let me know in the comments what I should try to make next.